Welcome to Season 2 of the Film Florida podcast. My name is John Lux, and I'm still the Executive Director of Film Florida. We're really excited about Season 2 of the Film Florida podcast and have a great episode to kick off the season. Representative Holly Raschein is a Republican member of the Florida House of Representatives from the Florida Keys. Representative Raschein is probably the biggest supporter of the film, television, and digital media industry in the entire Florida House. We talked to her about that, life inside and outside of the Florida legislature, and what's next for her after she terms out. Before we get to our conversation with Representative Raschein, a couple of housekeeping items. First, thank you for downloading the first episode of Season 2. If you haven't already done so, please be sure to subscribe, rate, and review the Film Florida podcast. The better our analytics are, the more likely others will find us. Also, since we last spoke, we launched a Film Florida merchandise page. Visit teespring.com/stores/Film Florida to purchase Film Florida t-shirts, sweatshirts, and coffee mugs. And now our conversation with State Representative Holly Raschein. Representative Raschein, thanks for joining us on the podcast today.
Thank you for having me.
So you are originally from Alaska, is that correct?
It is, all the way in the last frontier.
So what specifically about Florida and Florida State, other than the weather, attracted you to come down here?
Sure, and a lot of folks don't know, but my roots are in Florida. And a little known fact is actually my great-grandfather was a county commissioner in Lake County, and he was also in the Florida House back in the 1940s in the historic capital. So I think politics is in my blood. I knew that I wanted to get my degree in political science, and I thought, you know, being from Alaska, I didn't really get the difference between UF and FSU and UM and things like that, but I thought, you know, Tallahassee is the capital of the state of Florida. I'm sure if I get my degree in political science, I'll be able to get a job. And lo and behold, as soon as I graduated from FSU in 2003 with my degree in poli-sci, I got a job down in the Keys working as a legislative aide for the then state representative, Kim Sorensen.
And so it seems like you knew the minute you got out of school and then got that job, you wanted to run for the Florida House, but at what point did you say, you know what, I'm going to do this?
Well, actually, I don't know that I actually knew right away when I got into the process that I wanted to run for office. I mean, maybe in the back of my mind and deep down in my heart, I might have wanted to, but I got busy. I started volunteering for a board. I loved the Keys. I loved the community. It's a very unique place. And, you know, at the time when the opportunity arose to run for office, my former boss, state representative and former minority leader, Ron Saunders, was running for the state Senate. And there was an open House seat. And there were a couple guys running for, you know, the House seat and to replace Ron. But I thought, you know, I know Tallahassee. I know our issues. We're super unique. I had also just had a brand new baby. I had a newborn baby. And I thought, you know, I've got to resign to run. I've got this new baby. Why not get on the campaign trail? And lo and behold, I had a primary and I had a general election and worked really hard and was successful making it into the Florida House in 2012.
And for those that don't know, being a state legislator in Florida is technically, and we'll get into that, a part-time job. So do you have a job outside of the legislature?
I do. I actually have two other jobs, and, you know, we are considered a citizen legislature, right? So we have other jobs, and then we kind of govern part-time. To be honest with you, I treat my state job or my legislator job really like a full-time job because I do love
right.
it so much. And it is, you know, it's very time-consuming. But my other two professions is I have the honor of working for Mariners Hospital in Tavernier, and I'm a project coordinator for them. And also I do some work down in Marathon at Fisherman's Hospital. And then I also, my third job is as a market advisor for First State Bank of the Florida Keys. And First State Bank is actually the last local bank in the Keys. So it's really an awesome opportunity to get to work for a local company like that.
And outside of being a legislator, what do you like to do for fun? What are your hobbies or personal passions?
Well, of course, I live in the Keys, so water is my passion, whether it's scuba diving, snorkeling, just getting out on the boat and wading around in the water is fun for me on a Sunday. I also love fishing. Growing up in Alaska, I salmon fished and trout fished, but fishing in the blue water for snapper or grouper is just a totally different experience and so super fun. And one of my other passions, it's my personal passion, is the arts. I grew up dancing ballet and tap and jazz, and that's something that I've kind of carried through my adult life. I taught ballet, and I still try to get a class in every now and then. I enjoy going to see shows. And then also when I can get it in, and this is my goal, once a week, I try to get in a yoga class or two.
And I mentioned that being a state legislator is supposed to be a part-time job. And the legislative session is 60 days, and then you have about 5 or 6 committee weeks leading up to the legislative session. Now, I have a theory. Back when the state budget was $50 or $60 billion, that worked. But as the state has continued to grow and the state budget has continued to grow almost double now to $90 billion, legislators are essentially expected to do almost double the work in terms of settling the budget in the same amount of times that we had, you know, decades ago. And important things sometimes get left out, or it's possible that enough time is not dedicated to important things. Legislators just don't seem to have enough time. I mean, is my theory way off, or I mean, do you agree with that? How do you feel about where the legislative process has gone?
John, I completely agree with you. The pace that we keep is fast and furious. Like you mentioned, we've got 60 days when we're in session, and that's actually the only time that we can go on the floor and debate and discuss and actually vote on bills and pass them on to the Senate and then ultimately have the governor sign them. And it is a quick pace that, I don't know, I haven't really seen around our nation. I know there's other states that they meet all year round. But we do get a lot of work, as you mentioned, done in the committee process. And it gives the public and it gives the industries and the different interest groups an opportunity to come before the committees of whatever, you know, healthcare, education, mine, you know, is in the environment and agriculture appropriations, an opportunity to have input in the governing process. And I think this is what makes Florida such an awesome state to be a legislator in. But yes, the pace is can be backbreaking, quite honestly. But I think our voters and our constituents send us up there to get this job done, and I think we do a decent job at getting it done. But sometimes we have to come back for special sessions and things like that. If there's, you know, a natural disaster or unfortunately a man-made disaster, things like that, we don't have time to get our job done, and we have to come back. But all in all, it is you are dead on.
And I mean, is that what you would attribute? Maybe in the last 5 or 6 years, there seems to be more special sessions and extended sessions than there were maybe 20 years ago.
That might be the case, given maybe it's an economic downturn, or maybe like there's a big deal out there, whether it's on gaming or education, that, you know, is a polarizing topic, and we just can't seem to, you know, mark all the boxes and get all the votes in. But I think, thankfully, we did not experience a special session this year or last session, and hopefully this year is going to be a big campaign year. I know folks are going to want to get home and start, you know, getting on the campaign trail, so fingers crossed we won't have a special session again in 2020.
So what's the best part of being a state legislator?
There are so many good parts, to be honest with you, John. It's hard to really name them all. One of my favorites is actually being out in the community. You know, you get to be very social. Folks come up to you and they, you know, and it can also be challenging at the same time because people rely on you and they want to explain their issues and they want help from you, and you hopefully are able to help them. Another thing is just learning more about the issues, really taking a deep dive and getting our hands dirty and trying to figure out solutions that are going to help our state. And, you know, I represent a very, very unique area, all of the Florida Keys and southern Miami-Dade County, very diverse. Any given day, we've got the environment, or we have something that's attacking our avocado trees, some disease. You know, every day is different, and so that's an exciting part. Again, getting to just share all the good things that we're doing in Tallahassee with our constituents, and then also get their feedback. What are we not doing in Tallahassee? You know, hearing from people, and again, just getting to be out in the community, I think, is one of my favorite parts. And then, of course, equally important, helping people.
And what about the negative side? Is there anything that you could say is kind of the worst thing about being a legislator?
Yes, and there are unfortunately some more negative parts of being in elected office. Obviously, you have politics. Politics are politics, and that part can kind of, I guess, I don't want to say distract you or distract me from my job, but sometimes that, politics kind of weaves their ugly little head in every now and then. And then another bad part is sometimes you just can't help your constituent. There's a situation maybe that they've gotten themselves in that you just can't help them dig out of, and you have to tell them no. And that is really hard for me, and I know for my entire team when we just have to say, I'm so sorry, we can't help you, because typically when they approach us, they're at the end of the rope. They've tried all the other avenues, and somebody has said, well, try your state representative's office. And dang it, if we don't give it our best try, and then at the end of the day, sometimes we just can't help some people.
Now, before we talk about your support for our industry directly, what are some of your other priorities?
Sure. And again, going back to the district I represent, District 120 in the Florida House, we are a very environmentally sensitive area. We're the Florida Keys. We are home to the third largest reef tract, on the planet. Water quality is a huge issue, and that's probably one of my top priorities. And I've worked diligently throughout my entire career in the legislature to bring home funding for water quality, whether it's wastewater or stormwater, canal restorations. We've got, a massive seagrass die-off in Florida Bay. We've also got a disease that is attacking our coral reef. And so those are some of the issues that I spend a lot of my time on. And I'm able to do that through my role as chair of the Agriculture and Natural Resources Appropriations Subcommittee. And that is that's a role that I really cherish. And I'm so honored that the speaker has allowed me to serve in that capacity. Another priority of mine is also making sure that South Dade, the northern part, the northernmost part of my district is recognized. Being the southern part of Miami-Dade County, sometimes, you're kind of usurped by the bigger part of Dade County, the urban part. So making sure that those businesses and those small businesses and families are supported there as well. And one more thing that is very important to my entire district, and especially after Hurricane Irma, is workforce housing. We had a big issue with that prior to the hurricane, and it was just exacerbated after Hurricane Irma. We lost a lot of workforce housing. So I have been working hard to bring home dollars for that, as well as working on policy that will make it easier for developers and community members to access funds that are available for workforce housing to actually bring the dollars down more quickly for people like essential personnel, our sheriff deputies, our teachers, our healthcare providers, the people that are really the grease of our community that keep it going, that keep it working. And that is something that is one of my my proudest accomplishments.
And as I had mentioned in the intro, it's possible that you are the biggest supporter of the film, television, and digital media industry in the entire Florida House. But as you know, not everyone in the Florida House feels that way. So if I were a colleague of yours that doesn't support the industry as much as you do, explain your position. Help us understand why it is you support our industry so strongly.
Well, you hit the nail on the head, and maybe I perhaps am the biggest supporter of the film industry in Florida, because one, it is such a cool industry to be in support of, right? There's so much going on right now, whether you're in the digital world or actual filming or series and television and things like that. I mean, there's so much going on in that world, so that's easy to support. But then the economic benefits of the film industry are just mind-blowing, and that is something, that will always be there. Should we, and God forbid, we have another economic downturn, people are still going to, want to have their Netflix series or their big movies, or my son loves cartoons and things like that. So I think just the economic driver that the film industry is enough that I would hope would be able to garner a lot of support.
So let's talk a little bit about Bloodline. As you're obviously aware, Bloodline filmed 3 seasons for Netflix in South Florida, primarily in your district in the Keys. We'll talk about the actual analytics and the numbers in a minute, but from your perspective, as someone that lives and represents the Keys, talk about the day-to-day impact that you saw on the region when Bloodline was filming.
Well, first, John, I'm a huge fan of Bloodline. I just have to disclose that, and was so sad to see that we weren't going to have more seasons. But let me tell you, it was a tremendous impact on our community having Bloodline filmed here. You saw locals get involved, not even just locals like getting involved in the actual filming as extras, but local businesses. We had our sheriff's department involved. We had caterers. We had production people. And the cool thing, and this is so neat, and it's just something only I can share, and it's so personal to me, but the filming of the series actually transcended my entire district. So what they couldn't film on scene in the Keys outside, or in different garages or restaurants or whatever, their sound stage was actually in Homestead, which again is in the northernmost part of my district. So the impact was so huge and so incredible, and just again we're sad that it couldn't have filmed some more seasons.
So getting into the numbers just a bit, I mean, you touched on some of those aspects, but the Monroe County Tourism Development Council did a study after season one of Bloodline. So this is just season one. And the numbers, what they found was the production spending alone was a little bit over $30 million. And then there was an additional $65.1 million more spent in Monroe County by tourists that visited just because of Bloodline. They saw Bloodline on Netflix and said, holy cow, we got to go check this place out. In addition, there were more than 2,000 Floridians that worked on each season of Bloodline. So talk a little bit about, what that economic impact meant to your district.
Sure. And you, again, just called out the huge numbers. And this is when I want to go back to the economic impact. And that was the local economic impact. That's not what the entire state of Florida, got to experience from the filming of Bloodline. That was just my community alone. And we had tourists come from as far as Sweden to stay in the Rayburn House. We had folks come from all over the world and the nation to come to the Keys. And, they maybe went to the Bloodline, the Rayburn House or wherever, but they would go into the different businesses that were being filmed. And maybe if they didn't want to spend all their time in the Upper Keys, they would go down to Key West and spend a couple days. I mean, just the benefits and the economic benefits just kept coming and coming and coming. And just again, that was 1 year. What would it have meant if we'd had, 6 seasons or, 6 or 7?
Right, which is exactly what they had planned on doing. And Bloodline did benefit from the old incentive program that sunset in 2016. And once that program sunset, the producers of Bloodline, cut season 3 short and then canceled the season altogether after previously, like I said, saying they were going to do 6 or 7 seasons. So the bottom line was they needed that program to make the budget work. And so in the 3 seasons lost, Florida lost more than $80 million of direct total spending, hundreds of millions of lost in tourism. There's really no telling how much they would have lost if Bloodline would have continued season after season after season. And then again, more than 2,000 Floridians that worked as cast and crew for each season went away. So the flip side of the positive impact during the early part of the Bloodline years, what was it like around the community when it was announced that it was over?
Well, there was a huge outcry. Very disappointing. Whether you were a fan or not of the show, it was very bad news for our community to receive, unfortunately. And like you said, it's hard to quantify what was lost, in terms of impact dollars, the economic impact. And, I think the incentive, if you will, or, whatever we want to kind of call it moving forward, is the shot in the arm. It's the welcoming mat. We love the film industry in Florida. This is something that we're going to kind of give to you to incentivize you and to encourage you to come here and bring your dollars and bring your teams and bring your people. And unfortunately, we, with the season ending, or the show, I should say, the series ending so quickly, you know, it was just such a big disappointment. And I do want to highlight the series. It's nice to film movies or, you know, these one-time shots, but a series is long-standing. A series is around for years. The economic impact of the series is long-standing. And I think that's maybe something that we need to look forward as a state.
Well, and as you well know, we've been working diligently on a new rebate program. And a lot of the learnings we got out of the new program are based on the successes of the old program. And of course, there were certain challenges of the old program that are no denying. And so we've learned from all of those and essentially been able to put together a program that says, okay, what are the things that worked in the old program? Let's move these forward. What are the things that were challenges of the old program? Let's fix those. And once we can check all of those boxes, then we have what we feel is a great program for the state of Florida. And what we've been talking about is the most fiscally conservative program in America that ensures that the return on investment is exactly what Florida needs to both bring high-wage jobs, economic development, and enhanced tourism, as well as give the state back more than what they put into it. And so with your help, we've been able to make some good progress, and we hope to be able to continue that.
That's wonderful news, John, and I really couldn't agree with you more.
So your time in the Florida House is almost up. You have one more legislative session before you are termed out. What's next?
Wow, I can't believe it's almost been 8 years. It flew by like a flash. I had a newborn baby when I started, and I now have a second grader. It's just wild, wild,
wow.
Wild. But, you know, I've always loved the process, right? I loved governing. I loved being a staffer. I think I've got some pretty decent experience, and I'd like to kind of stay in the process in some fashion or some form. And whether that means maybe going to work for a state agency, I've always kind of dreamed about that, or going to, you know, represent a really cool cause like Film Florida, in front of the legislature. I'm not exactly sure what the future holds for me. My politically correct answer is I'm keeping my options open, which is actually the truth. I am keeping my options open. Again, I've dedicated my entire career to this process. I don't see, you know, making a big turn away from that. I do love living in the Keys. I do want my son to be raised here. So if there's some kind of, you know, partnership that I can form or an entity that's willing to work with me on that, I'm in. But stay tuned on that.
Well, that's great to hear, Representative Raschein. We really appreciate you making the time for us today so our audience can get to know you better. And I know I speak for our entire industry when I say thank you for everything you have done and continue to do to support the film, television, and digital media industry here in Florida.
Well, thank you so much for making me part of it.
Thanks for listening to this episode of the Film Florida Podcast. For more information about Film Florida, go to filmflorida.org or visit our social media pages on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and LinkedIn. Check out the Film Florida merchandise at teespring.com/stores/Film Florida. And please remember to subscribe, rate, and review the podcast.